Hi, my name is Saad Jbabdi and I'm from the University of Oxford. In this video, I will introduce the FSLcourse task fMRI data. The FSLcourse data comes bundled with other data from the annual FSLcourse. Check it out using this URL if you want to learn more about this MRI course. Here we're using some of the task fMRI data from the course. In case you're not familiar with fMRI, this diagram shows you how it compares with other types of data in terms of spatial and temporal resolution. fMRI makes measurements at the millimeter scale and at a sampling rate of about a brain per second. It's also worth bearing in mind that fMRI is not a direct, but it is an indirect measurement of brain or neuronal activity. It comes about through the Bold effect, which works in this way. An increase in neural activity triggers changes in the balance between red blood cells that have oxygen and those that don't. And that happens through changes in blood flow and blood volume, CBF and CBV. This in turn produces changes in the local magnetic field near blood vessels, which in turn affects the MRI signal. And as a result, the effect of change in neural activity through, for example, a stimulus produces this characteristic bold response shown at the bottom. The data is four-dimensional typically, three dimensions for space, one for time. In task fMRI, we apply a set of stimuli to the subject while they're lying in the scanner. We then fit a model to each voxel in the brain based on the stimulus timings and on a model of the bold response. We then use statistical techniques to find out which brain areas best fit with our model. On the left, you can see an example of a bold response of fitting data. And it shows part of the brain where the bold response fits with our model. And on the right, you can see some actual data from a single voxel alongside a model fit in red. We provide two data sets that use two different tasks. The first task is a language experiment. It is event-related, which simply means that the stimuli are very short in duration. Each stimulus belongs to one of three separate events. The first type is called word generation. Here, the subject is shown a noun on the screen. They must then think of an associated verb and say that verb in their head without vocalizing. The second time is called word shadowing. Here, the subject is shown a verb on the screen and they must simply repeat it in their head again without vocalizing. The third event is a simple baseline event where the subject is shown a fixation cross. The gaze must remain on the cross. Some more details on the task design. There are 24 events of each type. The order is pseudo-randomized, and there is a 6-second delay on average between consecutive events. If you model this data correctly, you may be able to identify some of the areas that are more active during some of these events. For example, here, I'm showing brain areas that are more active during word generation than during fixation. If you know your brain anatomy, you may spot Broca's and Wernicke's area there on the left hemisphere. The second task is called parametric. This is a combined auditory and language experiment. It is a block design with about 20 seconds per block. In each block, the subject is shown a sentence which is presented word per word at a frequency that varies between blocks. So here are two examples of a block 50 words per minute and another one for 500 words per minute. And so you can ask questions such as what brain areas are more modulated by the frequency at which the words are shown and ask whether, for example, that modulation is linear or quadratic. Both data sets are whole brain, but only from a single subject and not necessarily the same subject for the two tasks. They have already been run through standard fMRI pre-processing, such as motion correction and spatial and temporal smoothing. All you have to do is load the data and do some time series modeling. And of course, we provide a Google Colab notebook to help with that. So that's it from me. Have fun with the data.